Hi, my name is Don Godfrey, and I spent a year in Vietnam.
Hi, my name is Charlene Godfrey, and in 1965, I married Don, and within a short time, he was drafted, and at the end of 1966, he left for a year tour in Vietnam.
Okay. I was on leave, and I was told while I was on leave that I was going to Vietnam, but it was anticipated that I would go to Vietnam, and I thought it was my duty to serve my country, because that's what my dad did, so I figured that's what I should do too. So it didn't upset me that much, except that I had to leave my vacation early and go back to base to ship out. I think that's it. When I was drafted, I was shipped to California, and then I was shipped back to Fort Lewis and took basic training at Fort Lewis, and there was not much any part of it that I enjoyed. It sucked, but I did it. We arrived at Vietnam, we got off of our boat, and then we got on trucks, and we went to Pleiku to set up base camp, and I think everybody was nervous. It rained a lot, really rained. It was a monsoon season, so everything was wet all the time.
We had to dig
ditches around our tents after we put up our tents. And the first night our ditches weren't deep enough, and I remember we had to dig them deeper the next night because the water was running through the tents.
Don and I married very young. I was only 17, and it was 30 days after we were married, he was drafted. And then he went into training for about a year, and then he went to Vietnam. And you know, anticipating him going to Vietnam was really sad. And of course, we were always concerned that he wouldn't come back. And so I was very sad and did a lot of crying the whole year he was gone. And in those days, they didn't have telephones, you couldn't call. Our letters took 3 weeks to get to Vietnam, 3 weeks to get back. So it was a 6 weeks, round trip for our mail. And so there was very little communication at all. And it was a long year.
No, what about pregnancy?
Oh, and I was, I found out that I was pregnant just after he left, probably about 30 days after he left. I found out that we were expecting our first child. So I experienced the pregnancy without him there, and he didn't, of course, experience it either. Until he came home and then he got to see his son for the first time. Sent flowers to me on Valentine's Day, and a big black, looked like a big black car drove up in the driveway, and it had a sign on the side, and I thought they were coming to tell me that he had been killed. So I was really upset, and it was just the florist bringing flowers for Valentine's Day. But I immediately thought that they were coming to tell me that he was killed. And let's see. And then we also had an opportunity to go to Hawaii, and he had his R&R there, and I was able to go meet him in Hawaii while he was there. That was after about 8 months of service in the military, or in Vietnam, and it was really odd to see him after 8 months.
Yeah.
But it was even more difficult when he left. He left on the plane first, and I watched until his plane was completely out of sight. Because you never know if you're going to see him again. Well, I, even after all these years, whenever I see military men come home and their families are there to greet them, it makes me feel really sad. I know how they feel.
With Vietnamese people I had very little interaction with. I never trusted them, and so I was always on guard, so I didn't interact. Well, when I landed at, the Seattle airport, and going through the airport, there were protesters protesting that the people hated military people, so that wasn't very fun. Then after I got...
Did you kill us?
Yeah,
and
well...
spit on you?
Yeah, they were spitting. Yeah, they were just acting stupid. And so that wasn't a very good warm welcome. It's not like it is today when they come back. So when I was discharged, I left all my military gear at the military base and came back in civilian clothes, and that was the end of that chapter. I guess the worst memory I have is the truck, and we was running a convoy, and I was driving the deuce and a half truck, and the truck in front of me hit a landmine and blew up. I guess that was the worst thing. That another thing that bothers me was in running radios out to outposts in helicopters. We'd run the rivers, and then you'd get sniper fire, and I never did like that part either.
You weren't low to the river.
So we'd go. The helicopter pilot would always, you know, take it really low on the, along the water, trying to avoid the sniper fire. So I didn't like that. I guess that's the two things that stood out most to me. Mm-hmm. Well, while I was in Vietnam, my brother and my dad took a civilian job in Saigon, and I did an in-country R&R and went to Saigon and visited my dad and brother, and that was a good experience, but that's all. Yes, I was changed dramatically. Now I'm very cautious. I've always been cautious, and I don't like crowds. I don't like, you know, being around anything that's not comfortable, and I'm more reserved than I was before I went to Vietnam. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, when he returned, I expected him to be the same as he was, but he was different. He seemed to be more withdrawn, and there was definitely a different person, you know, different personality. So I did notice a lot of changes. It's just not what you expect. It's not what you expect at all. And of course, coming back, he had the responsibility of a wife and a child, and having to try to find a job. It was, and then, of course, coming from
a different country, Vietnam, he has to get back into life here in the U.S., which is really different. So I think he had a lot of pressures when he returned as well.
I guess the main point I'd want to get across is that it was really a waste of a lot of people's lives.
Mm-hmm.
And it should have never been.
Hello darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams I walked alone, narrow streets of cobblestone, neath the halo of a street lamp. I turned my collar to the cold and damp. When my eyes were stared by the flash of a neon light that split the night and touched the sound of silence.